So I like to start by discussing the basic idea behind the project and how it was born. And I present two different artistic interventions just to get you an insight and also maybe to show you how is my approach to that. So how did we start a project? It was, let's see what happens if. This was is really the spirit of experimentation that we first conceived of the project 4 years ago together with the German Cultural Foundation. And we wanted to encourage a productive dialogue between contemporary art in a natural history museum and to launch a pilot project that would show us what that dialogue could like in practice. And I have to say it here, this cooperation with the German Cultural Foundation gives us a very unusual freedom for experimentation, which is not normal in our times. And because also in the field of research, you have to specify your outcomes and your impact. And so this is really unusual. And I think this is, if when we are talking about model project, I would say this is a model project also for science. And the idea of starting an art project didn't come out of thin air. It was part in that time of a greater effort to systematically transform and open up the Museum für Naturkunde that had been initiated by its new general director, Johannes Vogel, in 2012. And a clean sign of this transformation, among others, was the establishment of a new department called PAN, Perspektiven auf Natur, Perspectives on Nature, which I had together with science historian Ina Heumann. And our mission, or PAN's mission, is to look at questions from the disciplines of history of science, cultural studies, and art, and in doing so, to shed light on the political, social, and cultural roles of the Museum für Naturkunde. And one of our intentions behind is to help to foster also self-reflective culture within the museum. So, and it was in this context that the idea came up to invite contemporary artists to explore our museum and to develop an artwork reflecting their insights and experiences with us. Not being experts on contemporary art by ourselves, we decided to work with external curators from the field of visual art, sound art, and literature. And their role, you have know, some of them you know already, Gabi Hartl, Kurt Riechelmann, Birgit Ahrens, Christina Heidemann, and Dorothee Brill. And their role in the project is to develop a concept and to suggest as artists for the experiment and to act as advisors and also as mediators for both sides. And when we ask the artists to create a piece, we give them the freedom to focus on any aspect of the museum that interests them. And our hope is and was that they will open new perspectives on the museum and that we will gain impulses, inspiration for us and the museum's visitors. And so we are turning the table on ourselves. We, the research establishment, became a research for perspectives from outside. To enable the invited artists to engage, we organize tours through the different departments because we are a really huge museum. We have many colleagues in many different departments, the research department, the taxidermy atelier, the collection departments, the education department, and so on. So it's a really complex institution, and it's also a challenge for the artists to find their way through because we are very complex. And we also give the chance to speak with our colleagues, depending on the chosen topics. And we offer the opportunity to all our colleagues to exchange with the artists about their ideas and methods during the creative process. So my aim in this project is really to shape understanding of both sides and that there is a kind of an exchange and a communication during the whole process and also when the works are exhibited. And the works that develops in out of this collaboration are displayed in our permanent exhibition. This is the next challenge because we don't have a separate space for displaying the artworks. That means that we have to find a place in our very dense and spectacular permanent exhibition. And we have regulations of monument protection and so on. And this is another challenge, really, to give the art the space that it's needed. And we have four temporary intervention rounds, the last one, now we're on the third round, the last one will be in next January. And for each one round, we also evaluating the visitors' reaction to doing this. We choose Lernkultur. Katharina Obens is here from Lernkultur. And we chose them because it's a mixed team of people coming from psychology, cultural studies, and arts. And so this was our aim, that we have partners of dialogue, and the evaluation is not focused on numbers, but it's focused on a quality evaluation, because we want to know what really happens, what do people think about, what do they appreciate, it, what might emerge in this kind of confronting people with contemporary art in our space. So you can imagine with this way to give a carte blanche, we got a wide variety of artworks that were created, and each addressing different issues. And I just want to show you two examples and the different artistic approaches and the different ways in which the intervention affected different audiences. And so, maybe you remember Gabi Hartl talked about it. The Norwegian artist Aka Dolfen was invited to participate in the first round in 2015, and she created a sound installation for a historic collection hall with mounted bird specimens. And for her research at the museum, Aka Dolfen spoke to members of the museum staff of the collection, of the bird collection, about the history of the collection, about their work at the museum back in the days of East Germany. And she also spent time alone in the room, which is otherwise closed to the public. The work was based on these conversations and her observations and experiences in the room. And it was also informed by her own memories of living in Berlin when it was a divided city. And what emerged was a multiplied 20-minute sound poem, and several different voices could be heard in. And in short sentences, they spoke of everyday situation, of border crossings, of uncertainty, and of uprooting and migration. The work was provided structures through lists with the place and date of the first time that the various species of birds in the collection were described. And this information gathered from the object labels was included, as well as a comment on the global history of the collection. The question who was speaking was left open. It may have been the bird specimens, the people who work or worked with the collection, or the artist herself. And then the room was opened at scheduled times for small groups so that the intervention took on the character of a performance. So to give you a feeling of or impression of the work, I just show you a short film clip. I hope it will work. It's around 1 minute, just that you can have an imagine how it was.
Warum sind wir hier? Wo soll ich fliegen?
Last night, who slept next to you?
He was next to him. She was next to her. He wasn't next to me.
Was it good? Was it cold?
Did she tell you something?
Ja, war 1823. Neuroman 1854.
When did you leave?
Secrets. The whole country has secrets.
Warum sind wir hier? Soll ich fliegen?
It's okay. No worries. I wait on the other side.
So So the only information accompanying the work was a short text by the entrance, and visitors were immediately confronted with this very striking room, its distinct smell of preservatives, and the sound installation. They were left then undisturbed and given the time to form their own impressions of the work as a whole. After a while, a contemplative mode set in that allowed you to hear and see more intensely, and that also made the contrast between life and death more acute, a contrast which is inherent in a museum, in our natural history museums. That at least was my experience and one that I shared with some of my colleagues, and the work allowed people to experience the room in a new and intense way and to observe the birth specimens with greater concentration, even for those of us who had been familiar with the collection for years, and to raise their own question. Their work didn't speak to everybody, but in combination with the impressive collection, it had the power to deeply move some of the museum staff and visitors. And our evaluation company, Lernkultur, conducted interviews with the visitors, and their work was vigorously debated in focus group discussion. There was a positive feedback on the unique, complex character of the space, the opportunity to concentrate on the work in a separate room away from the hubbub of the museum, and a close connection between natural history specimens and contemporary art. And in that time when we show it, it also gets in political context, because it was the time when many refugee people came to Germany, and the question of migration, and it became a topic in that artwork. So opening up this space literally made it possible to have a new sensational and aesthetic experience of a historic research collection, and the very ambivalence and complexity of the world allowed for multiple interpretations. It opened up a perspective on a museum as a place with many layers of stories and histories, the history of the collection, of the individual animals, of the room, and of the people who worked there. So for my second example, I'd like to show you a work by the Peruvian artist Fernando Bryce. You still can see it in the museum. And when we invited Fernando to be on the project, he had the idea in mind to work with classification systems in the collection departments. And in course of his research in the mammals collection, he came across a cardboard box with old labels that had been used for objects, drawers, and cupboards. It's this box you can see here. And another medium that he was drawn to was an inventory list for a collection of animal bones and scars dating back to about 1900. And these historical materials formed the basis for a large format picture circle. So you can see here on the right side the whole picture circle and a short part of it. That work is titled Paradoxurus adustus, in a play on taxonomic description. You can also see the pages of the inventory list that Fernando copied by hand and made large screen prints of, along with the label. And the labels contain the genus and species information about the collector, a color code that is related to the regional origin of the objects. And you also, maybe you can't see it in these pictures, but you can also see where the objects come from not only from the zoological garden, but also there are some labels which show that part of the collection comes from the former German colonies. And when you start reading the list, it feels so you're looking over the curator's shoulder as he works, and you are surprised by the meticulousness and his struggle to describe the objects precisely, and also by the pleasure he felt in recording particularly beautiful or rare pieces of the collections. And so Fernando's tableau showed or made a representation of the basic taxonomic work of the museum, the identification of species, the recording of the specimens in the collection, and the work for the first time get a prominent place in the exhibitions. The work highlights for me the poetry and the beauty of everyday things, of material culture in a museum. It raises philosophical questions about the nature of names and naming, and it raises critical questions about the colonial context in which the collections were acquired. So it may be the strong connection to their own scientific work that explains why that piece was received very positively by much of my colleagues. But in observing the visitors in general, we have to acknowledge, however, that it's clear that only a few take the time to explore this multi-layered work. And in addition, I have to say, if we got the critique in a focus group discussion that we maybe would like to use artists to address critical topics in our museum, this is not our aim, because we also in our research department, we are addressing the theme to collect or the history of our collection in colonial and times, for example, in an ongoing research project. We took this artwork, we took the chance to start with art nature talks, to invite the artists to mix together with scientists or researchers in our department to talk about these topics. And now we are going to shape the new permanent exhibition halls, and I think there's next week, and this is the very important moment where we have to discuss how to bring in these topics inside the permanent exhibitions. And also, I was aware of, maybe if you're an historian or you are thinking about taxonomy or naming and names in a philosophical way, you may be able to read the book and to read the work and to see the many layers. But if you want really to communicate these kind of complex topics, we have to give more information we have to address it by their own. And so I just to say, I wanted to give more place for the question. So, what is the challenge, or what are the limits? And the challenge is they are multifaceted. I'm kind of an interface between the artists, the curators, my colleagues, and so I think it's very important to open up a field of communication like we do it now in this conference, really to get to understand the work and the world of each other. It's not only the work between arts and science. We, as coming from the field of humanities, we have also to discuss to our colleagues coming from science to shape a mutual understanding for our questions and to create an atmosphere where we can really discuss on an open way. And the challenge now for me is to bring back all the very inspiring, very critical, very great artworks and the discussion back to the museum, and how to make it like kind of generator for the museum's further development. And and I have to thank all the artists, because it's not only about inspiration, it's about partnership, it's about addressing topics that are around here in the world, in this room, and also in a museum, bring it out and give them a place in the museum and to discuss it together.